So lots going on today. Today we are honoring the work of our national church and Presbyterian Sharing with our liturgy, and we're having communion and a barbecue, and we're remembering Canada Day a week early. So join me now as we come before God with our call to worship, and your part is the bold italicized part. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness.
Come into God's presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God.
It is God that made us,
and we are God's people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and God's courts with praise. Give thanks to God. Bless God's name. Let's sing together. Your name is holy.
Thank you.
with the gift of ourselves, I want to give thanks to Jared Aitken for stepping in on drums and fulfilling a lifelong dream. Well, not lifelong dream, but a dream ever since I've started playing drums. It feels a little weird not to have anything to do from 9 o'clock on, but it actually works out really well because there's a surprising amount of stuff I can get done. So thank you, Jared, for being here. And just to confirm all the rumors that you have suspected and heard and stuff, Lucinae Trosian, our music director, has handed in her resignation. It was a wonderful year, but stuff is moving on in her life and between the commute to Windsor and her growing family. And the fact that she is now working full-time at a Montessori school in Windsor, which is really cool. So that's wonderful. Yeah, we can give thanks. And her last Sunday hopefully will be the last Sunday in August, so we can have a little celebration for her. But she will be missed, but we are now immediately starting the process of searching for a new music director. So prayers for that, please. Just as God has blessed us in so many ways, let's come before God with our gifts now. Church all across Canada gets things done. Everybody shares a little bit. And part of the reason we share the way we do is from a story that comes out of the Bible about Jesus and a day of sharing that Jesus helped make happen. So here's what happened. Jesus was teaching a bunch of people, a whole bunch of people, more people than are in here right now, about 5,000 people. So if you can imagine your entire school and another entire school just as big and another school, about 10 of your schools, all of those kids, Jesus was teaching, and he taught, and he taught, and he taught, and he taught,
And he taught.
And finally, some of his friends said, "You know, Jesus, you've been teaching a long time. You've been here all day. The people are very hungry. Let's send them to the restaurants and get something to eat." And Jesus said, "You give them something to eat," because he wanted to keep teaching and they wanted to keep learning. And the people said, "Jesus, you're crazy. Because if we were going to feed all of these people here, why? Well, we just don't have enough money. We just can't afford to buy enough food for everybody." And Jesus said, "Well, think about this for a second. Does anybody have any food?" And a little boy piped up and said, "I've got my lunch." Now, I was never sure about this part of the story, because the boy's lunch consists of 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. He must have been taller and wider than me. I mean, I understand the 2 fish, but man, 5 loaves of bread. Anyway, he had 5 loaves of bread. And in those days, it wasn't, you know, the big loaves you get at Walmart that cost 99 cents to feed 5,000 people. They were just little round things. So he had 5 of these little round things and 2 pieces of fish. And Jesus said, "Well, that'll do. That's just enough." And now, we're not told this in the Bible, but you can kind of imagine Jesus' friends going in the background, "Jesus is nuts." But Jesus said, "Give out the 5 pieces of bread and the 2 fish." And they gave it out. And they gave it out. And 5,000 people later, they had leftovers. From a little basket, this boy's lunch, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, everybody, 5,000 people, 10 of your school, all had enough to eat, and there were baskets of food left over. Now, there are 2 things that we learn out of this story. First, Jesus can do miracles. Because obviously, you know, it wasn't as if people had their own lunches tucked in and pulled them out. All we have is 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish. So Jesus can make things happen that we can't. He can feed 5,000 people with just a little bit of food. But the other part of the story, and the part of the story that matters to our church, is the sharing part. Because if the boy hadn't shared his lunch, nothing would have happened. I don't even think Jesus could feed you out of, "Hey, have a nice bite of air." I don't think even Jesus could turn nothing into something, but he could turn what the boy shared into this miracle that fed 5,000 people. So that's why we share. Now, we can't maybe share 5,000 people. If I pull out what's in my wallet here, 10 cents. And Lynn, okay. I can't feed everybody with 10 cents, but you know what? If we all put together our 10 cents or dollars or $20, we can do miracles just by sharing. So that's why our church across Canada has this day called Presbyterian Sharing, where we talk about and celebrate how important it is to share and really how easy it is, because all that boy did was give his lunch to Jesus, and he turned it into something wonderful. So let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you.
God, we thank you.
For sharing.
For sharing.
For little boys' lunches.
For little boys' lunches.
And the gifts we have to share.
And the gifts we have to share.
Help us to give to others.
Help us to give to others.
So that you can do miracles.
So that you can do miracles.
With what we share.
With what we share.
Amen.
Amen.
So are you going to go with Ralph or Brian, or are you going to stick with me? Got some questions? And let's bow our heads together in prayer now. And you'll notice that we should have some prayers there. Yes, good. So your part is the part in bold and italics. God of the universe, we come to worship and to praise you because you are the creator of all things.
You spoke in the earth and everything that was made.
You came to us as Jesus Christ. As he spoke, he taught us about your great love for us.
A love that is to be shared with us.
You come to us today through your Holy Spirit, who continues to speak your word to us.
Your Spirit teaches us how to love and care for ourselves and for others.
Holy Triune God, kindle in us the fire of your love and set our hearts ablaze with excitement for your enlivening word this day.
All glory, honor, and praise be yours, our Holy Triune God, Creator, Redeemer, and Counselor.
Amen. Friends in Christ, hear the good news and believe. The scriptures assure us that if we confess our sins, God will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thanks be to God. We pray these things in Jesus' name, who taught his disciples this prayer. Let's share the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now I'm going to invite Paul Escott to share the word with us.
Our first reading today is from Proverbs 18, verses 12 and 21. I, wisdom, dwell together with prudence. I possess knowledge and discretion. To fear the Lord is to hate evil. I hate pride and arrogance, evil behavior and perverse speech. Counsel and sound, judgment are mine. I have insight, I have power. By me kings reign and rulers issue decrees that are just. By me princes govern and nobles all who rule on earth. I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. With me are riches and honor, enduring wealth and prosperity. My fruit is better than fine gold. What I yield surpasses choice silver. I walk in the way of righteousness, along the paths of justice. Bestowing a rich inheritance on those who love me and making their treasuries full. Our second reading is from Luke 16, verses 19 to 31. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire. But Abraham replied, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. And now he is comforted here and you are in agony. And beside all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been set in place, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us. He answered, Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them.
Christ to you, pray the
want to read to you a little story that was suggested by the folks at National Office for our Presbyterian Sharing Sunday. American theologian Don Messer tells the story of a rich man who was approached to contribute to major financial campaigns. The urgent need and compelling case were stated, and a call was made for his support. The man responded, "I understand why you think I can give $50,000. I am a man with my own business, and it is true, I have all the signs of affluence. But there are some things you don't know. Did you know that my mother is in an expensive nursing home?" "Well, no, we didn't know." "Did you also know that my brother died and left a family of five and had almost no insurance?" No, we didn't. "Did you know that my son is deeply religious, has gone into social work, and makes less than the national poverty level to meet the needs of his family?" No, we hadn't realized. "Well then," the rich man said, "if I don't give any of them a penny, why do you think I'll give any to you?" And with that, we walk into the story of Lazarus and the rich man. Now you'll notice two things in the story I just read to you. We're given the name of Donald Messer, the theologian who had this project that he wanted to accomplish and who did other good works throughout his life. But we're never told the name of the rich person who refuses to give even to his own family. That's exactly what happens in our story that Paul read this morning. We are given the name of Lazarus, who was poor and rejected, and because he had nothing and was nobody, he ate at the crumbs, or he ate at the door of the rich man, whatever might happened to fall off the table. But the rich man is unnamed. Lazarus, we're going to assume, was a good man. Or at least he was a man. He didn't stand a chance. But he gets a name because we're told frequently that Jesus goes for the rejects and the outcasts. We're told that Jesus sits with the sinners. Lazarus gets a name because Jesus knows him as a broken heart, as somebody that is worthy of his love, but because he's the most unworthy of them all. The rich man, however, gets no name, as happens so often in the Bible. We're given generalities, we're given broad strokes, we're given titles. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the rich people, the rulers. But these folks that Jesus uses as a negative example never get a name. Never get a name. So the takeaway from this part of the story is the simple fact that Jesus knows those he loves by name. Jesus knows the people that serve him, that take care of him, that help others, the outcasts, the rejects, by name. And he seems not to know, or perhaps to ignore, those who ignore, or who are hypocrites, or who hoard their wealth, or who simply don't fall in line with Jesus' desires for others. That's our big takeaway from the two stories, from the story Donald Messer related and from the story of Lazarus and the rich man. But there's something more to the story of Lazarus and the rich man. It's not just about a reward. It's not just about who Jesus favors. There's a special passage. Bring that up, please, Pete. He said to them, this is Abraham talking to the rich man. If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. So here Abraham represents the ancient story. Abraham represents kind of the ideal follower of God. And he's talking to the rich man, and the rich man has asked Abraham to send a representative back to earth to tell them that if they don't change their ways, they're going to be in big trouble. That it's too late for the rich man, but it would seem that his siblings are acting the same way, that they too are failing to do any good for the poor or share their wealth. And so he asks Abraham to send Lazarus, to send this poor guy back to earth in order to warn the people, warn these five siblings, that if you don't change your ways, you're in for a very hot, uncomfortable time. But Abraham replies, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, if they don't listen to the holy texts, if they don't listen to what Paul read first from the book of Proverbs, if they don't listen to those texts, they've got them written right there in front of them. They've got the prophet, like Micah, who says, what does the Lord require of me but to do justice, to walk humbly, or to seek justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God, right? Thank you, Lois. She read Proverbs and Micah. But the people already have everything they need laid out before them. And I have Lois sitting there before me to remind me of what I should be saying. But they have these instructions, right? They know what to do. They've been told over and over again that it's justice that they desire. Jeremiah says it. Isaiah says it. Hosea says it. Amos, Obadiah, Habakkuk, Nahum. All of the prophets point to the same thing. And Moses as well. So if these people have the text, if these five siblings, if this rich guy have the text before them and refuse to read them, where are they going to end up? They're going to end up in a warm, uncomfortable spot. While those who either honor God's word or who have been rejected by society and were the least, people like Lazarus, are going to find themselves in God's presence, because God is a God of love and justice and mercy and kindness. So for us, the two takeaways are, God will know us by name when we do right. God knows us by name when we do justice, when we share our gifts, when we act with mercy, when we warn our friends that there is correct behavior. And the other takeaway, of course, is that we have to do what's right. We've got the example. We're told by God. We know what's right, and we have to act on it. And our national church takes this very seriously with this, two programs, but one is Presbyterian Sharing. And Presbyterian Sharing is what makes our national church work. It pays the stipend for the staff that holds our denomination together. It pours into my pension plan. Thank you very much. You're helping with that. You know, it makes ministry possible. It keeps our seminaries going. It plants new churches. It pays the salaries of our staff who are involved in mission work. Now, there's the big one. Presbyterians Sharing pays for the staff that does our mission work, which means that when you contribute to Presbyterian World Service and Development, most of that money goes to where it needs to go, because we've already paid for the staff. Now, there are some administration costs, but it's less than 7%. When you think about other charities and how much goes to administration, ours is pretty amazing. But that's because we have this thing called Presbyterian Sharing, where all Canadians contribute towards national office, pay for the staff, so that that doesn't have to come out of the donations for mission work. So Presbyterian Sharing is our way of coming together and having Chatham represented on the world stage, and having Chatham help churches in Vancouver, help outreach places like up in the north and in North British Columbia or out east. Here's a little video that explains it better than I can.
What's the meaning of the song?
The song means that it's a Victorian song of the soul. That we depend upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever we're going to meet, whether problems or what, we know we are going to conquer. We are conquerors. That's what it means.
Great.
Thank you.
Cover some of their old songs, because what was happening was, you know, white people brought in the church, but they also started just singing all of the popular songs and news in their traditions. So Presbyterian World Service and Development helped a campaign to have the churches and the singers recover their older songs. So this is one of the original songs that they sang today. Now there should be another video after that one, he hopes, talk specifically about Presbyterian Sharing. That can work? Will that work?
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in our sweet day.
So that's the nutshell of what our church is about. And if you just go to the last slide, Pete. Oh, that's it there, isn't it? Yeah. This is our Presbyterian Church in Canada website. And if you read the really small print, it says, PCC joins interfaith appeal to end famines in four countries, South Sudan, Somalia, Nigeria, Yemen. You may have heard that there is a food crisis in those four nations. And again, this is the kind of work that Presbyterian World Service and Development gets involved in. And Presbyterian World Service and Development wouldn't happen if it wasn't for Presbyterian Sharing. So we operate from our congregation. This is Presbyterian Sharing at work to the national and international stage through Presbyterian World Service and Development. So when you're sharing as Presbyterians, it's not just so that we can continue here and I can have a lovely pension and whenever I can retire 10 years from now. It's so that we serve God's kingdom throughout the world. And the wonderful, amazing thing about it is that God knows every one of you by name when you serve Him, when you love Him. And His gift to us, perhaps the greatest way He shared, is through His Son, Jesus Christ, who gave us this meal that we are going to celebrate now, this gift of bread and wine. And as you come to the table to receive your gifts, we're going to serve by intention today. Know that because you love Him, because you serve Him, Jesus knows you by name. Amen. We're going to pray together. Let's bow our heads together, and your words are all bold and italicized, so we read together. Almighty God, on this Presbyterian Sharing Sunday, we ask you to empower all the ministries and mission of our national church. Help us to learn about the important work that is being done as your people are ministered to and inspired to seek after you. We pray for all the people supported by Presbyterian Sharing and ask that you would lead them in the work you have given them to do, whether in Canada or in other lands. We especially pray for the people who are working with those who sit at the gates of our rich communities praying for help. Gracious God, show us how we can get to know these laborers in your fields and appreciate the work they do. Show us how we can get to know the people who are being helped. Loving Lord, help us to be your eyes, feet, and hands in our world, bringing your love and care to people in need. We pray all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to sing.
Thank you.
Here is the wonder and the blessing of Holy Communion. Within the Presbyterian Church in Canada, we believe that all who have been baptized and who know the love of God are worthy to come. Thus, there is no denomination, there is no single specific religious group other than those who believe in Christ and have been baptized. All are welcome here. Join me in our communion liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right to give God thanks and praise. Now let's pray together. Loving God, we are here on earth, yet through your Son you transport us to heavenly heights. We approach you as we have done many times before. When we turn our hearts over to you, you make them brand new, pure and clean, giving us a chance to start again with the same tools we began with a new vision and fresh passion to carry on better than ever. We may come to you humbly, empty-handed, heavy-hearted, but you fill us with grace, the same grace that lifts off our burdens. We may come to you with little to offer and less to commend us, but through Jesus you give us more than enough to make us worthy, and even more blessings to give away. Now we ask that you help us receive Jesus through this blessed meal and to celebrate his most amazing gift as we join in with the heavenly choir that praises you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Faithful God, in this holy gift of bread and wine, we remember all you did through Jesus. We remember he promised new life, that he would never leave us, and that he would make us your children. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you, Holy Spirit, for showing us Jesus in this meal. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for us so that we might have new life in you, a mystery beyond understanding, expressed in these ancient words. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. God bless these elements of bread and wine, these words and these actions, and all those gathered in Jesus' name. Open our hearts to feel his love, our bodies to feel his presence, and our minds to know his forgiveness. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, broke it, and said, This is my body, broken for you. Do this in memory of me. In the same way, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said, This is the covenant sealed in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Now today, because we are having our hamburger and Sunday lunch right following church, we're going to do communion just a little bit differently. Instead of coming to the front, I'm going to meet you back there at the door where Linda Quick is seated, and we will have the elements there. So you just come along that way, take the elements, and this time when you dip the bread into the wine, you can eat them right away, okay? Because it's a little more messy. So once you have your communion, bread and wine, please go ahead and enjoy them immediately, and then take a place at the table, and we'll have our final prayer and benediction there. So Audrey, can I ask you to take one cup, please? So come on, folks, I invite you to come, and I have the real wine, and Audrey has the real grape juice. So,
what am I supposed to do?
Oh. Thank you.